Please welcome to the stage Dr. Kate Stone, founder and chief executive officer, Novalia LTD.
Hi. Thank you for being here. So yeah, my name's Kate Stone, and this is my first time on a stage in 2 years, as I'm sure, like, been hiding away in the Zoom calls like everybody else. So it's really awesome to be here and to be alive, which is kind of a bonus. So my background is I'm a scientist. I studied electronics and then physics. And then I ended up kind of going down a rabbit hole of creating things out of paper that were a little magical. And I founded a business doing that about 15 years ago. And we've worked with a lot of different agencies and brands and created some fun experiences. So we've done things like for Pizza Hut, turned the pizza box into working Bluetooth DJ decks that you could DJ with, which was fun. And for McDonald's, we turned the tray liner into a music production station, so you could be having your burger and fries and touch it and it connects to your phone and you can produce music on it, which is fun. What else? For Bud Light at South by Southwest, we made walls of music. One of them was a 50-foot long wall in the street, and you could touch it and it triggered all different types of sounds. And inside we made some other music walls too. So it's been really fun creating these things over the years, these kind of branded experiences. And normally when I speak, I bring a bunch of the things I've created with me, demos, and I make music and I pretend that I'm a DJ with my paper DJ decks. I tell my kids that I travel the world and DJ to thousands of people and that on paper I'm the best DJ in the world. I'm actually a terrible DJ. But today I don't have any of my props, any of my things, which I normally hide behind. Because, you know, something I've thought is if I ever made a video of the work that I've done, I would actually only be interested in a video of people's faces, of seeing how people react to the things that I make, hearing them say how they feel about the experiences that I've created. Because although I'm a technologist, I'm actually much more fascinated by people, by who we are, how we work, what motivates us, what drives us, what makes us glow. And in my talks over the years, I've started to speak more and more about that. And then on a phone call with Kat, I spoke about that and she said, that's what you should talk about. So today I'm not talking about my work. I am talking about 6 reasons why I believe the future might look more like the past than the present. And I will say, I am not a futurist. I am a physicist. I am not a psychologist. So these are just my own thoughts. So the first one is probably the only one that's really about technology. And it's really about nothing, I guess. So it's really about technology shrinking until it becomes nothing, until it becomes invisible. And when I think about the journey of say, computers, a computer not too long ago used to fill a room. Then it filled our desk. Then it was on our lap. Then it's in our palm and on our wrist. And actually, a couple of years ago, I was at a conference in Denmark, and they asked me if they would mind injecting a chip into my hand. So there's a chip in my hand, and I've only ever used it once, and it was to open a hotel room door in Baltimore. I've absolutely no idea why I did that, but I did it and thought it was fun. it might turn out to be useful one day. My brother once told me a story of how he slept walk naked out of his hotel room and the door locked behind him. So, you know, he went to reception with a tablecloth. So you never know when you need that chip in you. Where was I? So, and then I think about the transistor. The transistor was only invented in 1947. And they invented it in some semiconductor material and had some little wires sticking out. And in 1959, Richard Feynman gave a lecture where he said, there's plenty of room at the bottom. And what he was talking about is how much space there is when we get really small. And the silicon chip was only invented in around 1960, so not even that long ago. And when I was doing my PhD, 20 years ago, I used to patent silicon transistors that were just a few nanometers in size. And I used to do that to create circuits to move around electrons one by one. And I remember after I'd created them, and I'd go on the scanning electron microscope on my 5-millimeter chip, I'd zoom in and in and in and in and in. And it just staggered me, like, how much you can zoom in. It just staggered me how much space there is inside absolutely nothing. And so that's where technology is going. We can now fit more transistors on the side of a grain of sand than we could fit on an entire beach. And all of the transistors in the around us, they're all made just from sand. So something that's like that can contain something that's so small, and all the tech is just going to shrink until it becomes invisible. And not just in electronics, if I think about medicine too. So recently I actually managed to get COVID, and I've had to spend a little while in quarantine and get over that. And the way it hit me most was I was just incredibly tired. And so my job was to just sleep and sleep and sleep. Well, this amazing vaccine that all these scientists have made and frontline workers have given us, the actual science that goes on inside our body at a microscopic scale that we can't see. So all that science that's developed gets shrunk into something we can't even see. And our job is just to sleep and let that amazing technology do its work. And so the point of this first one really is just to say, technology used to be about the big things. Anything that was based on tech was about things that we can see. But technology is going to be about the things that we can't see. So in the future, I believe we will see very little technology. It will just wake up and it'll be gone. And something like a cell phone now will just look like an old-fashioned brick. So that's the first one. The second thing that I think about is nostalgia. And I think that as humans, we're really driven by a sense of nostalgia. And I think nostalgia creates an image of a place in the past that probably never really existed. You know, it's really kind of a myth, but it makes us feel safe. It makes us feel like we're going home. We like things that give us a sense of nostalgia, even if it's not true. So I don't really like this example, and I told myself I wouldn't use it, but even just the slogan, Make America Great Again, is a nostalgic slogan based on a bullshit time that never existed. And and even if it did, it existed for very, very few people, certainly not for the rest of us. But it creates something that moves people. It creates a movement, and people get drawn towards nostalgia. When we think about technology, when we created digital radio, we created radios that looked like old-fashioned wooden radios. When we create lights with LEDs, we make them look like candles. When we create things that warm us, we make them look like fire. When we do our Zoom calls, we like to have a bookcase behind us of all of these books that we've probably never even, I never opened those books. But we have this high-tech world, and we disguise it and we cloak it in old-fashioned things. Think of steampunk or cyberpunk or Afrofuturism. When we take technology that you cannot see, that's invisible, that's just around us, and it's there for us to use when we want it, or just to enjoy its form when it's not, and you combine that with nostalgia, I think I can already start to see a very old-fashioned world. And when we see films like Dune or Foundation, those futures in centuries, they actually look really old-fashioned. So it was those two things together started me down this track. The next thing that I think about, and I don't really know where all of these things have come from, but the next one is what I call friction. when I think about, it's kind of about technology, when I think about technology in terms of humans and our existence, it's really always been about removing or amplifying our abilities or making it easier for us to do things, helping to keep us safe. And you know, it starts out with some simple stone tools or how to recreate fire or the wheel or the plow or the printing press or communications or the steam engine. Technology has always been about making us safer, making our lives easier. However, I think we're reaching a tipping point where we've created so much technology in our lives to make our lives so easy that we're no longer almost needed in our own lives. We're almost superfluous to our own requirement. We don't even have to think anymore. If something's on the tip of your tongue, the answer is at the tip of your fingers. It's just on your phone, you don't have to think. Like, I really hate it when I'm having a conversation with someone and we're kind of going, oh, what was that film? Or, you know, what was that particular thing? And then someone just sits there and Googles it and then says it with, like, you know, the total wisdom of Wikipedia as if there's some kind of expert. I'm just like, fuck off. I wanted us to go through the process of thinking about it and like using our brain and like expanding that parts of our brain. The more we develop technology, the more we remove our agency from our own moments. Friction, which, and we say, you know, how can we remove the friction from a consumer's journey? Actually, we need to build friction back into people's journeys, because I think there's good friction and bad friction, kind of like we say about cholesterol. There's friction we need to build in, because friction is what makes every moment meaningful, mindful, and memorable. If there's some friction when we do something, we remember it. If there's some friction when we're trying to do something, it draws our attention into that moment, and it can bring meaning, and it makes us mindful. That's what being mindful is. So, you know, and I love the friction in my life. I love it if I have to go out and chop firewood or prepare some food or go on a journey to find some vegetables or grow some vegetables. And you know, I mean, this, you probably know the story, I think it was from the 30s or the 50s, when they created instant bake your bread or cake mixes, and they realized that they had to put they had to take the egg out and have people add the egg themselves, because without that, with it being too instant, people didn't have a sense of being part of that journey at all. So I think it's something we can explore a lot. How can we add friction instead of removing all friction? And how can we create a sense of branded friction? Something that in a moment when someone experiences a brand where they have to do something that makes them stop and think and makes them remember that experience. And I mean, can you imagine sex without friction? That wouldn't work very well, would it? right, where was I going next? I need the friction of forgetting what I'm going to talk about, so it brings me back. So the fourth thing is what I call mind space. So again, I'm not a psychologist or psychiatrist, so this is kind of made up. But as we know, we have two halves to our brain, left and right. And when I think about like what is our mind, because we tend to use the word brain and mind interchangeably, and I'm defining mind as being whatever we use to form our thoughts, what we use to think in its entirety. And so I believe that our mind has two halves. We have an inner mind in our head and body, and we have an outer mind that is everything around us. And we connect our inner mind to our outer mind via our five known senses. If you imagine an animal that's in the forest, how it thinks, how it senses, how it knows what's around it, is through the other animals, the sounds from the other animals, what the trees look like, what they think using their surroundings. If you imagine taking a spider out of a web, is that still a spider? And if you take an animal out of the forest and put it in a zoo, you've literally ripped it out of its mind. And I believe that we are the same. We tend to think that we kind of have an arrogance where we think this is who we are, this is just me, and everything around me is just you know, the playground that I can play in and use and abuse and do whatever I want. But everything around me is who I am. It is how I think. If I say to someone, where do you have your best ideas? They'll often say, in the shower or going for a walk or chewing a pencil. If they weren't doing those things, they wouldn't have been able to form those thoughts. Therefore, those places are their mind. I love going hiking. And I hike through the forest and stand on top of a mountain. And when I'm going through the forest and I'm out there on my own or I'm stood on the mountain, I kind of imagine, like, because I'm a physicist, I guess, but I kind of imagine these like magnetic field lines that are connecting me to everything I can feel around me. And all of these lines, they have like a different thickness depending on how much data is coming in. And they have a different color depending on what sense. So I kind of like visualize all of these colors. And so feeling the wind blowing over my skin and the smell of the grass, or hearing the sound of the rain coming, and then, you know, sleeping out under the Milky Way and looking at the stars, I feel connected to everything. I feel connected to the whole universe. I feel that I am the universe. I feel like that I am part of the ultimate mind. You know, and given that's how we can all feel, that all our minds overlap, then we are all just one thing. Like, who I am is part of who you are. And once we can start to feel that, I think we can start to see others as if they are us and treat ourselves as other with a lot more respect. Where's it going? And then I kind of come from the forest and I come down the street and I pull my cell phone out and I'm walking down the street. All those field lines, they go zhoom, and they all kind of bend into this cell phone. Not very many colors, because there's not much. There's a bit of sound and sight and a little bit of touch. And they're very thin because we can't like get much data between the two. And I'm kind of like, you know, walking down the street and then I walk into a lamppost or people fall down holes. Because when we don't walk with these things, our senses are connected to everything and we can automatically detect each other. And people just naturally avoid each other and we go on our journeys. We don't even know we're all connected, but we are all connected. But whenever we're in a scenario and we pull this thing out, we become connected just to that and no longer to each other. We disconnect from our mind and from everything that is around us. And I think if I start to think about that and I think about friction and how friction brings us into the moment, the less we're needed in a moment to have to do these things, the more we're connected into that thing, the more we're disconnected from our mind. And I think it negatively impacts our mental health in a very serious way. I find it really upsetting, and I just kind of want to get back to that, being in nature. Oh my gosh, I've got 1 minute for two things. Okay, I'll try and be resourceful. The next one is resourcefulness. My gran used to say to me, you need to learn to cut your coat from the cloth at hand, which I thought meant being really frugal. And I imagined going into her lounge one day and seeing a coat shape cut out of her curtains. But that never actually happened. What it made me realize is if we create what we need from what is around us, we, with resourcefulness, we're accidentally very resilient. Before the pandemic started, I'd gone to an event, it was about saving the world, and there was no vegan food, there was a crazy use of single-use plastic, and it really upset me. So I went on a plastic diet when I went home, and I used what I call the kitchen oracle, which is the trash can, and I went through it, and I found plastic bags for food, and cans for beans, and cartons for milk, the worst thing of all, plastic boxes for lettuce. And like, why the fuck do we put lettuce in a plastic box that will sit on the planet for 1,000 years and was used once? It's just crazy. So I bought a flour mill. I started milling my own flour to make my own pasta and making my own soy milk to make my own tofu. I set up a hydroponic system in the pantry, growing spinach and kale and lettuce and all those things, and connected it to Alexa so it was voice controlled and had a camera on it so I could watch it from wherever, which is kind of fun. But then what happened was apart from me being really smug, when the pandemic hit and the shit hit the fan and everyone was running for toilet paper, maybe to wipe the shit off the fan, I'm not really sure whether that's why they're... All I did is double down on milling my flour, you know. But it did used to take me 6 hours to make a lasagna, which is, you know, which is a long time. But I think the thing is, the whole point of that, this is, when we use whatever is around us, wherever we can, whether that's resources in the form, you know, of materials, whether that's people, whether that's local people, local knowledge, not only is it resourceful, it creates inbuilt resilience. Because we live in a world that's trying to be more and more homogeneous and do everything at lower and lower cost. And we end up with these crazy supply chain issues because we've created a world that's incredibly vulnerable. And that vulnerability comes from a total lack of diversity and using what is around us. The only thing that stands between us and extinction is diversity and is using the things around us. That's so important. Oh gosh, I'm gonna have to just grab two more minutes to do the last one. The last one is about community. And I'll try and tell a quick story. A few years ago with my daughter, she was 21 at the time, we went for a weekend with some preppers in the forest in upstate New York. This like tough, was led by this tough New York firefighter. And these people were a certain demographic. The firefighter who was supposed to lead us on our weekend of learning how to be prepared, forgotten it was his son's birthday and had to go home. So that never happened. And then the other tough guy who stepped up had a car with a bad battery and needed to borrow my jump leads on a night when we're sleeping in the forest at -5 Fahrenheit. So these preppers, it turns out, are not very prepared. But one thing they told us to bring was a radio. So I went and got myself a ham radio. And I got a license. I learned how to use it. And then during the pandemic, a group of people around Woodstock, where I was living, started to do a morning QSO, which is a conversation, from our QTH, which is our home, at 8:35 on the 146.805 megahertz repeater on the mountain outside Woodstock called the 8:35 on the 8:05. Anyway, what I learned was what happens when you build a community of people who are really different and people who have never met, and you do it through a form of communication that's really simple. So Paul AC2UQ would crackle open the radio at 8:35 and we'd all be there tuning in to listen, and there was Jim K2BHM building his steam engine in his garage. There was Bob KD2QAK who had been shooting turkeys. And then there was other Bob, I've forgotten his call sign, who was driving down the mountain to open the pharmacy to test more people for COVID. And every morning we shared a minutiae of detail of our lives that was really boring. But on the radio, one person can only speak at a time. So 90% of the time or more were listening to each other, to these strangers, and we take it in turns to speak. And then when it comes to our turn, I was kind of shy and didn't want to speak, but I'm given the microphone and I have to speak, and I have to say my minutia of detail of my life, and so does everyone else. And that minutia of detail of everyone's life, who is given space to speak, who's forced to speak, creates a rich tapestry of community. Because I believe that we have to recognize that the quietest in the room most often has the most to say. And we have to not just give the quietest in the room space to speak, we have to make them speak and make them feel heard. And it's a rich community and resilient community is only built when we listen to every single voice, all of us around us. And it's combining all of these things together, invisible technology, with nostalgia, with the importance of building friction into experiences, with the importance of being resilient, and understanding that our mind is everything around us and how to build community. That's why I can imagine a future that could look more like the past and the present, because if we don't, I don't think we have a future. And I kind of imagine that we're on this spaceship time machine Earth, traveling through space at the speed of time. And there's two dials on the dashboard, that are in the red. One of them is the rate of suicide, and the other is the destruction of our environment. We are literally killing ourselves and destroying our home. And if we don't stop thinking about technology and start thinking about who we are and our world and each other, I don't believe we have a future. So that's why I hope we can go back to an imaginary place that didn't exist that could be a wonderful future. So thank you.